might say, well, do you know Vladimir Kramnik? Of course you do, a legend, you know, former world chess champion. Well, even though he retired, it seems that he didn't lose all that much interest in chess, because here he discussed this idea with some good people at the DeepMind, Demis Hassabis and, some other gentlemen. I will put a link in the description below where you can read more about this. But basically, Kramnik said that professional chess is becoming very boring, and he mentioned that in the World Chess Championship match between Carlsen and Caruana, all 12 classical games ended in a draw, which is not surprising since they have to go into pre-prepared lines, you know, down the memory lane, and basically blitz out 20 or so moves, and then it's basically a position where the position is equal and both of them are able to hold this. Now here, also, Kramnik mentions that you do have Fischer Random Chess or Chess 960, that Wesley So is now the world champion of. It's interesting, but a lot of players don't like it, and even the very top elite players, some of them don't like it, as they don't feel comfortable playing it. So here, Kramnik proposes a variant of chess that's basically normal chess, so you can still apply normal openings, you're just not allowed to the castle. And here, what they did in DeepMind, they let AlphaZero learn itself chess from the beginning, like they did, you know, when AlphaZero started the learning chess, but with the exception that castling is not allowed in this version of chess. So what happened is that the game became much more interesting. Well, from a human standpoint, of course, we enjoy, you know, crazy sacrifices, you know, open lines. That a lot of stuff is happening on the board. We don't enjoy slow maneuvering positions where it's, you know, maybe I will push this pawn someday. So that's basically it, and this is one of the games that is available in the article. So like I said, the first thing you will see in the description below is a link to this article on chess.com. It says it's by Vladimir Kramnik himself, so we might do, you know, to question that. So do check it out, but now let's check out the game. And it's always, well, it's always impossible to analyze AlphaZero's games because you cannot use a conventional engine to check if Alpha's moves are good or not. And this is even harder, because here, even if you have like an abnormally strong Stockfish, maybe Stockfish will tell you, okay, that's a good line, but it will not be working here because castling is not allowed, because Stockfish might say, okay, play that, and then castle on move 7. That line is useless to us because you're not allowed to castle on move 7, for example. But as soon as one player moves the king, well, after both players move the king, then you can, again, use conventional engines to analyze your games, because then the position will somewhat be comprehensible. So without further ado, let's check it out. Let's just call them Alpha White and Alpha Black, or maybe Alpha 1 and Alpha 2. We'll see how it goes. I still haven't decided. So the two moves are predefined. So E4 with C6, the Carl Kahn, D4 and D5. So it is as of this moment that both alphas are on their own. We have Knight to C3. Like you would usually do, D captures on E4, Knight captures on E4, and the Knight to F6. And here already a very interesting move by Alpha. If you put this to any engine, you will most likely get Knight captures on F6, Queen D3, Bishop to D3, in some very rare cases, maybe even Knight to G3. But here, Alpha just retreats to C3, and it is a move that you will not very, very often see. But okay, like Kramnik mentions in the article, if you check it out, you know, it's probably the best way to develop your pieces. So who are we to argue with Alpha? With E6 by Alpha, Bishop to E3, and now Queen to C7. Just, you know, nicely developing, and now H4, something Alpha usually does, playing on both sides of the board, pushing H4, H5, A4, A5, developing the rooks, not in the conventional way, you know, castle bring rook to A1, but now you can do rook H3, rook G3, you can put a pawn to H5, go rook H4, then you immediately have the rook on the fourth rank. So very interesting, as usual. And now Kramnik mentioned that in some of the games they were analyzing, Alpha replied with H5 to H4, but here we have Knight BD7. We have A4, now again playing on both sides of the board, awesome stuff. We have H6, Kramnik mentions in the article most likely an early, you know, the defensive idea against the G4 and the G5, so you already have a pawn guarding G5. Knight to F3, continuing development, and now A6, probably preparing C5 as, well, if you just push C5, then the B5 square becomes available for the knight. With Bishop to C4 by Alpha White, and now Bishop to D6. again, developing. And here you would see probably castles if this was a regular game, but it's not. So king to f1. The king will be very safe there. You can develop the queen, you can bring the other rook over to e1, you can develop this rook via h3, so a lot of possibilities. We have b6 by black, and now comes queen to e2. As we discussed, bishop to b7, now preparing to push c5, this bishop will then open up, and rook to e1. And here comes, now we will most likely see queenside castle or kingside castle if this was a normal chess game, but here we have king to e7. And it is of this moment, as of move 13, that you are now able to analyze the position with conventional engines, because now castling is no longer allowed, and you can analyze it. So, bishop back to d2. Seems odd putting your king on e7 when you have the queen and the rook controlling the e-file, but the idea is probably bringing either of the rooks here and then marching your king over to the king side, or marching the king to the queen side. So basically, you have to castle artificially. We have rook h to e8, continuing with the plan, and now, without wasting any time, Alpha White needs to seize the initiative. So here, g4, offering a pawn. Knight to e5 isn't all that great because of c5, you challenge the defender of the knight on e5, and now just captures, you're gonna bring the other rook over here, hide the king to c8, and the black will be perfectly fine. So here, g4, saying that, okay, if you capture, I have rook g1, not a very nice pawn, but I will get a semi-open file for my rook. Knight df6, and now you're gonna go knight to e5, where you will have problems as black. Either you will capture this guy here, and then after recapturing, you will force this knight back, which will remove the defender of the g4 knight, or if you capture with this knight, then after captures, you open up the g-file for the rook. So here, after g4, Alpha is not about to be triggered by the other Alpha, so c5, now opening up this beautiful diagonal, and now comes d5, closing it and hoping to open up the e-file. King f8, of course, and now d captures on e6, and here is where things get completely crazy, and one of the reasons why this is definitely the perfect game. So here, Alpha Black plays b5. Now, of course, you cannot capture anything here since your queen would be hanging, but there is another really crazy line, queen to c6, which just... I will show it. I'm just going to show it. So, you're offering, you're threatening to capture on f3. So here, queen to d3, offering a trade. Knight for bishop on d6, but now comes knight to e5, attacking the queen, and a triple attack on the knight. So knight captures on e5. Now, queen not captures on h1, but queen to g2 with check. King to e2, and now bishop captures on e5, and here rook h to g1, pushing the queen back. Queen to h2, and now white continues the attack with g5. So the knight is under attack, pawn captures, bishop captures on g5, and only now f captures on e6. And here you would get queen to g6, and you have this incredibly complicated position where anything can happen. They have it, obviously analyzed by Alpha, and it appears to be an equal position. But imagine you were playing, okay, Alpha is playing against Alpha, so those are two opponents of the same, or, you know, maybe very, very close in strength. But imagine if you had this position against someone your own strength, or maybe someone slightly weaker or slightly stronger. Would you call this position equal? So that is what I ask, ponder on that. Alpha doesn't like to go this way. So instead, b5, attacking the bishop with a captures on b5. It's basically b5 is to open up the a-file for the black rook at some point. So a captures on b5, and now knight to b6. With the threat of knight captures bishop, and then after queen captures, you pick up the knight on f3. So again, there are two ways to go about this. Rook h3 is one way, just add another defender to the f3 knight, and now if knight captures on c4, queen captures on c4, a captures on b5, knight captures on b5, queen moves, and you have this position, where again, Alpha decides that it's not the best way to go. So after this knight to b6, we have g5, so continuing with the attack. Knight captures on c4. Now, what do you do here? You could either capture on c4 or capture on on f6. If g captures on f6, this doesn't work because of bishop captures on f3. And now, of course, if you capture the bishop, knight captures on d2 with check, picks up the queen, and if you don't, round after bishop captures on f3. If you play queen captures on c4, then bishop captures on h1. And after queen to g4, threatening queen captures on g7 mate. Black has f captures on e6, and now this opens up the queen's defense to the g7 pawn, and black will be now better. So after knight captures on c4, you don't have g captures on f6. You have to play queen captures on c4. We have bishop captures on f3, and now rook to g1. Just putting up, setting up a rook for the g file that will soon open up. We have h captures on g5, h captures on g5, that's not a capture, h captures on g5, attacking the knight, and now knight to g8. And here's a very interesting moment where in the article, if you've checked it, you've seen it, Kramnik says that this is the only good move, and it's hard for our human brains to understand why this is the only good move. For example, if you try knight to d7 to try and give up some material back to stop white's attack, then white has queen to h4. Very exciting stuff. And now after f captures on e6, you have g6. Knight to f6, and now bishop to g5. So white's attack keeps mounting up. Knight to g8, and now queen to h3. Putting more pressure to the e6 pawn, but also attacking the bishop on f3. Bishop back to b7, and now the star move of the variation, b6. This b6 is available through the entire game, but in most of the lines, black just hates it. So here, the b6 pawn is under attack. Of course, if you capture it, then you remove one of the defenders of the 7th rank. So here, let's say queen to d7. If queen captures on b6, then you can just pick it up. Rook captures. Queen captures on e6, now threatening mate, and after queen to c7 defending, now you have knight to d5. And if bishop captures, then you have queen captures on d5, and it will just be very hard to defend this. Even though you're up a piece, let's say rook e8, you're going to get rook to h1, and now, for example, rook h8 is coming, the g8 knight